All team, give it everything you got.
It's time to fangirl flail with Fangirls Going Rogue.
Count me in.
Never get between a Mandalorian and a weapons package.
This is the way.
News, discussion, and commentary from the female point of view.
You call this a diplomatic solution?
No, I call it aggressive negotiations.
She's as important as he is.
With your hosts, Tricia Barr and Sarah Woloski.
Boy, am I glad to hear your voice.
Strap in, because this is where the fun begins.
I like the sound of that.
Welcome, Yub Cubs, to Fangirls Going Rogue. You have joined us for a really special episode that we are super excited about. Now, I am Sarah Woloski from Skywalking Through Neverland, and please welcome my fangirl co-host and friend, Tricia Barr from FANgirl Blog. Hey, Tricia, have you been reading any good books lately this week?
Let me think about that. The Princess and the Scoundrel. Yub neb.
That's right. We were both lucky enough to get some review copies, some advanced copies of this novel by Beth Revis. And it's published by Del Rey and it releases August 16th. But we wanted to release this special Fangirls Going Rogue episode all about this book and our thoughts. So you can listen to it. There will be a few spoilers, so just so you know. So if you want to read the book beforehand, that's great. But if you don't want to read the book and just want to hear our thoughts, then we're going to share that with you. All right. Let's tell why we decided to do this for Fangirls Going Rogue.
Both of us are huge Han and Leia shippers. So we're Leia and Han shippers, however you want to do it. But, you know, before they gave them cute little nicknames, there was Han and Leia in my mind. Empire Strikes Back is like one of my favorite Star Wars movies. It's one of my favorite movies of all time. And so this sort of just builds on that energy of our fandom. I know over the years, you and I, Sarah, have talked about Han as a favorite character and Leia as a favorite character. And you know, a lot of times when you're really passionate about two strong characters, shipping them just ends up being what happens.
Indeed. Yeah. And I mean, for me, I was brought into Star Wars because of the Han and Leia romance. So it really touches deep with me. And I know in previous episodes of Fangirls Going Rogue, when this book was announced, you know, immediately I began thinking of The Courtship of Princess Leia by Dan Wolverton, which is a novel that came out in 95. And I was like super into that novel because, of course, it explores the Han and Leia relationship. And so, you know, we can't help but like, okay, well, this has to be a topic for Fangirls Going Rogue because it hits both of our buttons, right?
You got to talk about things that you're passionate about. And to be honest, I haven't read all of the books. That's where I started, was in book fandom, but I haven't read all the books in the last 5 years or so. And this one I just devoured. So I would say, if you haven't read the book, stop, read it. You're going to want to talk about it and think about it. You can talk along with us with this episode, because I think we have a lot of really good thoughts and inspiration from the book.
Cool. All right. So you know what? I'm going to go into a summary here of the novel, and then we'll get into our discussion. Yub nub. So Princess and the Scoundrel begins immediately after the Battle of Endor, like pretty much after that final shot, right, of the Return of the Jedi. All of a sudden you hear Leia and she's thinking about, what is it, the stormtrooper helmets and how they were being used as drums, which I thought that was hilarious. And so now the book doesn't waste any time. It invites us to share in Han and Leia's wedding ceremony, after which the two depart for a honeymoon on the Halcyon. And I love that they tied this in to Senator Mon Mothma's ties to the Chandrilla Starline, because she is the Chandrilla, what is that, senator, right? Yeah, thought that was cool. So now Han and Leia board the Halcyon's first luxury cruise after the Empire's fall, on a very public journey to the most wondrous worlds in the galaxy. and their marriage and the peace and prosperity it represents is a lightning rod for everyone in the galaxy, including Imperial remnants still clinging to power. Facing their most desperate hour, the soldiers of the Empire have dispersed across the galaxy, retrenching on isolated worlds vulnerable to their influence. As the Halcyon travels from world to world, one thing becomes abundantly clear. The war is not over. But as danger draws closer, Han and Leia find that they fight their best battles not alone, but as husband and wife. Aww. So before we get into the nitty-gritty details, let's just share some immediate first thoughts on the novel. And Tricia, you just finished reading this, right?
Literally today. And I devoured it, so that's a good sign.
Yeah.
This is way more hopeful than Beth Revis's first Star Wars book that people might remember and have read, Rebel Rising, which was the story of Jyn Erso. That was a heavy, dark book. And there's heavy thoughts and ideas in this book, but it's definitely a more hopeful story. And just being who we are and Fangirls Going Rogue and just the celebration of having the Ewoks in anything. And so that whole part just made me smile. There is a line in there where Han and Luke are observing the Ewoks greet C-3PO, and one of them is leading and Han grumbles, "We've got to get the Yub Nub commander out of there."
Yub Yub.
So I was like, yep, you know, we say yub yub, but yub nub, whatever. They're little furry creatures that make funny noises. And that's how we interpret it.
I agree. So my kind of immediate first thoughts on the book, I always look at books like from the point of view, because that's one thing you can do with books is really get into people's point of view, their thoughts and everything. And I thought it was interesting that Beth Revis chose to alternate Han and Leia's point of view. So you could really, so it's not just from like Leia's point of view, right? But you could really see the two of them and their relationship with each other develop through the alternating points of view. And it's almost each chapter it changes up. And sometimes you get the same like situation, but from the other's point of view. So I thought that was nice. And I feel like this was more of an internal story happening. Certainly in the first 100 pages, it's pretty much all about Han and Leia's wedding and them trying to like deal with their spontaneous decision to get married, right? And be like, oh, wait a minute, we're not like two individuals anymore, we're a couple. So that was pretty neat. And then after that, it finally kicks off into like an external, like, you know, okay, this situation, this problem that they must deal with together. And I think my favorite part about the novel is just Han's love, like his love for Leia. Like there's parts that she describes where Han can't even like form a sentence because he's just like so flummoxed as what Leia looks like or something. It's just, I love it. It just gives me, he's Twitter-pated, right?
Oh, she steals the best things out of romance novels, which is that sort of, you're still seeing it. I mean, the original trilogy is really Luke's story. And as you said, we're picking up and we're getting to see kind of what's happened for these characters that have been kind of thrust into this adventure along with Luke Skywalker and what the ramifications are after this big event. I mean, they're even dealing with the ramifications of that, you know, little bit of news. Hey, we're related and Darth Vader's father, by the way. There's so much going on for Leia at this point. She's got a lot to deal with. So, you know, that's one of the reasons they have to do a lot of internal work at the beginning.
Yeah. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. Now, one of the things I could have done more with, I don't know, I could use more sex. I mean, they refer to it, like there's these little lines like, oh, and he took her hand and they, you know, and then the door closed or something, you know, like it's very, but you know, I don't know, they could give me a little bit more. I that's just
a little bit more of the spicy spice instead of your imagination. I'm just wondering if there's edited pages that Elizabeth Schaefer and Jen Heddle on the editorial side and that Beth have there that they could just pass along, you know, that they were like, yeah, this is great, but we're not going to include it in the Star Wars book. So ladies, if you ever listen and you ever have those, you know where to find us. Contact at fangirlsgoingrogue.com.
Nice. Awesome. Yeah, so let's talk about this love story and the wedding. So there's this wedding that happens right away. It's so cool. And it, because they're on Endor. Well, okay. So, you know, back it up. I'm going to say I do love the fact that, like, so I have to compare this to Courtship of Princess Leia. I just do. So in Courtship of Princess Leia, you know, Han and Leia, it's been like months after Endor, and they have each gone doing their separate ways again, like they do. Like Han's leading some battalion for 5 months, and Leia's working with making the New Republic, the politics, all that stuff, right? And so he's finally coming back. He's like, oh, I'm gonna see my love. And then all of a sudden you have this Prince Isidore thing, which, you know, throws a wrench in the works. But in this one, because it's set immediately after Return of the Jedi, the story is that everyone's so high on this, oh my gosh, we've fought the Empire, we've won, emotions are high, adrenaline is high, let's get married. You know, like it makes sense, actually, emotionally, like their decision to get married right away. And I think within the space of a week, they get married on Endor with the Ewoks. And so I think it works in terms of the emotion of the situation.
Well, it kind of banks off that idea. And I mean, it was true during like World War II, World War I. A lot of people, like, as they're, you know, the war was ending or the war was happening, it seems to heighten emotions. And yes, a lot of people got married. You know, my grandfather married my grandmother. He knew her for very little time during World War II. And, you know, she ended up marrying him, moving to be with his family. They met in Australia where she was working. And so there's this heightened sense during war that, you know, your time is maybe finite and that you need to act on the emotions you feel. And so it makes sense to me that it happened this way.
I mean, there's a whole generation called the baby boomers for exactly that reason, because everyone comes home from the war in 1950 and makes babies.
Yeah, it doesn't seem unreal to me. It seems to me very much how, you know, everything. They even mentioned Shara Bay and Kess. So we see Poe's parents in there a little bit. Same thing. He's kind of a war baby, same type of idea. And so you kind of get to see like that tie into that. So that was fun.
Yeah. So let's move into this wedding, which happens at this, it's like the tree, right? The tree of life almost. And it's very spiritual for like the Ewoks and nature. And I thought that was neat how they tied that in, including these fun little flower flyers.
I want like a painting of that or artwork. The way she described it, it sounded so beautiful. It reminds me a little bit of the idea of Avatar when you had the little floating creatures come down from the tree. To in my mind, that's sort of how but you know, maybe like they were kind of like butterflies, but space butterflies. And it just sounded so beautiful and romantic. And, you know, they had the little organic rings that tied into this whole like natural ceremony. I don't know. And they've used the tree as an idea of an important element in the Force, even when in Star Wars, that in the Disney era, they had the Force tree that Luke had planted. And so I think back to that, and I think back to the tree cave in Dagobah, how trees kind of embody this idea of energy and the Force. And we do see Leia deal with the concept of the Force in the story as well. So it was really neat to see that kind of, you know, they described it as a temple, the Ewok temple, I guess.
Right.
And I thought it was really cool that they had Mon Mothma like arranging this, like in the way that maybe she stepped in somewhat as like a parental figure in the loss of her, who she very much describes as her true parents in this book, which is Bail and Breha. So they even remember back to, you know, that moment in the wedding when she's imagining and she believes that Breha's strapping that sword on. And I got like all
me too.
Misty eye. And I was like,
me too. It's like, did she feel the Force, or was she just a sense memory of her parents? Like, that was so sweet. Like, she sensed her dad, like, kissing her on the forehead, right? And mm-hmm. her mom strapping the sword of the Alderaanian sword. And I, it did get to me emotionally when she was thinking in her thoughts how had Alderaan still been there, her wedding would have been on Alderaan in the palaces and
And what, five ceremonies and and whatnot. You know, it would have been way different had there not been this war. It would have been a different journey, and she probably wouldn't have met Han either.
Very true.
It might have been more like the courtship of Princess Leia, which was a marriage of, you know, a diplomatic arrangement.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. All right. So I want to hear, because I love when you talk story, Tricia, because you're so good at like dissecting the story structure. So can you tell us what you got from this novel in terms of the story structure?
I think when you were reading the summary, it sort of broke down the story in the way that it happens. So you have the wedding, which is sort of like the opening act. And then there's the journey on the Halcyon. So you get to see parts of the ship and you get to see them kind of settle into, I can't say it's the unease of new marriage, but figuring it out, right? Because it's different. It's different than not being married. There's things that you have to, you know, you can't always just be about you. It has to be about the other person and the things you want. So you're having to refigure who you are. And then after the journey, you go to the intrigue on matters, is how I say it. Is that how you say it?
You know what? In the audiobook, they said madures. But you can say matter, but in an interview with Beth Revis, she says matters like you do.
Okay.
Matters. So it's whatever.
It's like Han, Han, Leia, Leia. Yeah.
It works. It works either way. Unless the audiobook just didn't consult her and was like, madures. So I just say madures because otherwise it sounds like, you know, oh, this matters.
Matters.
You know, like it's a little confusing. So that's all.
Beyond that kind of that layer of those three parts, the wedding, the journey, and the intrigue on the planet, there's an internal story for Leia and Han becoming a married couple and the kind of they have to resolve that. And then
And that goes all the way through.
And then the external story of the rebellion becoming a government, which isn't, you know, necessarily complete, but the sort of idea of how they are going to have to deal with every different world in a different way. And this, and we see one potential solution in how they have to get people to ally with them after a lot of planets didn't buy into the Empire, but they didn't really have a choice. So they're thinking, you know, any of these like galactic overarching governments aren't good, right? That's where some of them are going to be. So they have to kind of,
which makes a lot of sense. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah. It's like, oh, we were just like, yeah, overthrown with this empire, so why should we trust you, kind of a thing. And we get that. We get that.
And I just wanted to mention, because there were some lines in this book that were so beautiful. And as an author myself, I'm like, look at something and I go, I really appreciate how they framed it. And this is from the book. She may be a princess, but not one from a story. Because when a princess from a story reached her happily ever after, that was when the story ended. But Leia realized this story, her story, it was an ending. It was a beginning.
Nice.
So that's kind of really that her internal story that really encapsulates it. And if you were going to talk about the story, like what's the MacGuffin, you know, talk about what's the thing that's kind of driving this. It sort of dropped in when Lando is there talking before the wedding about planning and the whole kind of galactic situation. And he keeps talking about Tabana and the Bespin, you know, he's thinking about where he's from and the fuel. And so it's this idea of a resource. And if we could even think about how that ties into our current life now, a lot of the things that we talk about are how much fuel prices have increased. So this idea of fuel as a resource that makes the government and makes our lives happen is just very real. It's very kind of real life for now. So, you know, that's their thing. Everybody's looking for fuel. And if they don't have fuel, then the shipping lane shut down. And it's a way for the Empire to kind of regain their footing, because truly the Emperor's dead, but that doesn't mean that there can't be people who step into that kind of power structure and use those resources. So the end of the Return of the Jedi is the defeat of the Emperor, not necessarily the end of the Empire. And we see that in the sequel trilogy. We know that the battle over Jakku was about a year after.
Right. You
know, so they started to win the Civil War, but they didn't necessarily win it for a while. So we're in that kind of fertile area of what's going to happen.
Well, plus even that, like the Emperor being dead is not a finite like fact at this point, because no one's seen his body. No one really, this is just what's been told. And it's a huge galaxy. So there's Imperials who don't think he's dead. You know, it's like, oh, business as usual, especially on the planet Madurs.
Somebody's, yeah, the Imperials there don't necessarily believe it because they're so far removed from it that,
right,
you know, they're still getting orders from somebody. They're still have something to do. And as long as somebody's given the orders and the paycheck's still coming and the base is still being funded, and it becomes more obvious to Leia over the story that the Emperor had contingencies in place.
Right.
Even if he didn't survive, he wasn't going to just go away.
Well, speaking of that, in the very first like couple chapters, they mention, you know, Han went with a group to the other side of Endor because they found another base that actually sent a bunch of info out into the galaxy after the Emperor died. Did we ever get a follow-up to that in this story? I don't know.
I
really
think that's
did.
Just a little bit of the idea that there's, you know, definitely other things happening. There's machinations in the Empire. They're not just going to go away and roll over because the guy who wanted them and created the Empire is gone now.
Right. Let's go and share some of our favorite passages or moments in this novel. And Tricia, you have like a ton.
I do have a ton. I have to say, there's this one line early on, and Leia thinks that she was just so tired of being strong. And I felt that in my heart.
Yeah, I can see that.
You know, there's days when you I mean, obviously we identify with Leia. So
yeah,
there are things about her resilience and the way that you feel like she's never going to buckle. But I remember over the years just talking about Leia as a character, and they never gave her these moments of weakness in the, this is the pre-Disney era books, you know, the New Jedi Order, Legacy of the Fate and Fate of the Jedi and all those. It was always about how strong she was. And it was just a simple expression of, I don't always want to be this way. And this book allows her to be very vulnerable at points.
I agree. One thing I love about this novel, and it struck me in the face when I first opened up the book, is the very first splash page, where in any Star Wars novel, you get that big Star Wars crawl over two pages because it's replicating when you see on screen the big Star Wars in your face. Well, in this novel, it's Han and Leia in the words. And so I was like, and they're kissing, they're in their pose where they're kissing.
Please somebody make that into a t-shirt.
Yeah. Oh, that's a great idea. Oh, I love that.
Wouldn't that be great?
So yeah, that struck me. That would be awesome. I would, but I can't do it because it's copyright.
Oh, darn.
Okay, share another one of yours.
One of the interesting things, just looking at the story, is they talk a lot about the legacy of Darth Vader being her father and her Force abilities. This sort of weaves through the story. But I don't think the story was in conjunction with Kenobi. Like, it feels like it's missing those bits that she would have known from the time with Obi-Wan. So that was the one thing. There were some moments in the story where it's like, I think, you know, she'd be like, Luke's Force and this, that, and the other. I'm like, but she would see it as Obi-Wan's Force as well. And so that was just like the one thing. And I know things are moving forward and they don't necessarily share all the information, but it's like, that's the one little thing in the story that sort of just stuck out to me, is like, okay, I think if they had that knowledge, it'd be slightly different.
I absolutely agree with you. And I started reading this book like 3 weeks ago, and I was fresh off Kenobi when little Leia, as 10 years old, you know, we can it's obvious she's using the Force to read people, right? And so I feel like had she known that, Beth Revis known that going in, she could have incorporated that more. And I think it would have really landed more, because as these things are coming out in our world, you know, like, oh, that's obvious. Like, little Leia had Force ability. She didn't know it. It would be cool for her to discover that as a woman here in this novel. But unfortunately, they're like two different divisions. They didn't necessarily talk. So yeah, totally agree with you.
I think that's the one thing that would have made this book stronger. And, you know, as we know, there's always things that have deadlines and when they're done. But
yeah,
you know, that was the one little thing I was like, okay. But then again, they did a lot of she did things that tied it into other longstanding stories. So you have the Imperial Alicia Beck, who has a past with Han Solo. And I had to be like, okay, where is she from? And I had to go all the way back to Smuggler's Run, which is a Greg Rucka middle age novel to see that character. So she's the Imperial with the cyborg eye. What does he call her?
Okay.
She has the dead shot. So, you know, they did do some cool interconnecting things, drawing characters from other places.
Okay. Okay, cool. I do have to say that it was really funny as I was reading about the Imperial Alicia Beck, the way she's described in this novel. She's got blonde hair that's slicked back super straight in a tight bun, almost like she's bald, right? And she's got her ISB outfit and stuff. And then I see the Andor trailer with a character very similar to that, except for the cyborg eye. I was like, wait, what? ISB? No, it's not the same. It's not the same character. But like for a minute there, it was really funny because I had just read her character introduction in the novel and then this trailer comes out.
The ISB ladies definitely have a certain look.
Yes. Right? Yes. I will say that. All right. Well, I want to talk about, let's see, on page 99, we finally get on the Halcyon and there is a fun Easter egg, especially if you have been on the Galactic Star Cruiser, where Captain Riola Keevan is welcoming you all in. Well, in this novel, which is set before the events of when you are on the Galactic Star Cruiser, Riola Keevan is a character, but she is not the captain yet. She is the quartermaster. So I thought that was really neat, a fun little nod there. And she talks about the fact that this Star Cruiser, everyone, you know, is part scattered across the galaxy. And then on this one moment, this one space, everyone is there and it's a shared journey. This moment in time is a shared journey. And so I just thought that was a really cool way of putting anything. And you could almost think of moments in your life that way. And I love that. I love that idea.
It's so true too. I've been on so many cruises, river cruises, ocean cruises, all types, Alaska cruises. And that's really kind of something they drive home on those cruises. Like people end up making friends on cruises that they wouldn't have known from other parts of the country, particularly kids, you know, they'll get to meet other people. I know there are people I follow now on social media that we met on the Galactic Star Cruiser adventure that we did that media preview, and I follow them and I watch their lives, and you know, occasionally they'll comment on one of our things and I'm like, oh, it's just so cool to have, you know, met these people on a cruise. So I just feel like it's, for us at least, having been on the Star Cruiser, I think some of the stuff might impact differently. And I know, like, just some nodding to the compass. They mentioned that on page 108. And I really feel like that was like a nod to, she talks about the idea, Leia's looking at it, of how the compass would make, you could use it to stay on course, but you have to have knowledge. You have to have a thought. And I look, thinking about how she's struggling with the idea, if I use the Force, am I grabbing power? Would I be like my father? No, could I be like Luke? And really it's this idea of having an internal compass that guides you. And that's where the Jedi Order fell, is they didn't allow people to have a compass. They just said, no, you won't have attachments, not give you tools to say, I'm attached to something. How do I deal with that as this powerful Force user? So that was a nice, I thought, way to work in that idea. It's, you know, it's not something that she's trying to drive home, but it's a little idea that's in her head as she's writing the story.
Also, D309 appears. And if you've been on the Galactic Star Cruiser, your little in-room video, you touch it and this droid pops up and talks to you or tells you a bedtime story or sings you a song. Or and so it's really funny because she's the one, the droid who welcomes Han and Leia to, she like escorts them on the Halcyon for one thing. And also she pops up and Han gets into a spat with her. And at one point, I just love this in the novel. At one point she pops on the screen and she calms Han and Han's in the suite and he's buck naked. I thought that was really funny.
That's enough of a visual for me. There was one time in the New Jedi Order that Luke got buck naked because you fell into a vat of little, I don't know, creatures and microscopic creatures and they chewed his clothes off. So we did have Luke one time in a book that was naked. So there is precedence here.
Okay. That's funny. All right. What other Easter eggs did we notice?
I love that they did some stuff in the engineering room, which... Yay. Even in the Lego Star Wars Summer Vacation, Poe says, oh, we're going to go to the engineering room. And it sounds like it's like this goofy like thing that
tour or something.
Yeah, that doesn't sound like fun. It's like Poe saying the engineering room. But the engineering room is like where a lot of cool things happen in the Star Cruiser Adventure, depending on the choices you make. And I think even depending on the choice you make, you might end up in the engineering room at a different time. But like, so some of my favorite moments were in the engineering room. And one of the things that's in there are the initials that Han inscribes or etches in the walls. So we get to see when that happens. Of course it happened in a Sabacc game.
Right. I thought that was so cool. I was like, it's happening. It's happening. Let's see. Also, they mention the sublight lounge here, which is the bar of the Star Cruiser, and Han, I think he initially goes there first, and he learns some Sabacc, but it's not intense enough for him, so that's when he wanders off to the engineering room. But it's fun to see that. Ooh, and the bridge, of course.
One of the favorite little things that they worked in was the backstory of the art in the atrium that is, you see in all the shots that everybody takes when, you know, from all the little events that happen in the atrium, there's this artwork in the back that was donated by Leia. So you kind of get the story of what the inspiration was for that and where it came from, which is an artist from Madurs.
Yes. And then I just want to go over the fact that their Galactic Star Cruiser experience, the Halcyon, Han and Leia, was very much like our experience on the Halcyon, because when we went, we were on like the first experience that was being filmed. Everyone was filming and stuff. And for Han and Leia, this is the first cruise of the Halcyon after it is no longer under Imperial control. And so it is another big publicity event. And I felt like that very first scene in which Leia is in the main atrium and everyone's coming up to her, like trying to get their little piece with the princess, felt very much to me like Ashley Eckstein when we saw her on the bridge, the Halcyon, and everyone was, not everyone, but like, cause people were doing their own thing, but like, you know, oh, you noticed her and you wanted to say hello and say hi and, you know, get your little, so I just felt the big, huge parallel between Ashley Eckstein and Leia in this novel.
Oh, for sure. There's so many, just that way that everything she did was scrutinized and it was yes. Important. Like it was important to make an impact and say, you know, we've moved on. The Emperor really is dead. We could, you know, we could get married. We could start cruising again. You could have fun things. You can, you know, do whatever you want. The Chandrillan Starliner is no longer under the control of the Empire. And so all these things are really important. And that all kind of plays into, I think, our biggest location, the intrigue at Madurs. And it was really cool, like the setting of this planet. No, I'm sorry, moon.
Yeah, yeah.
And a different kind of environment. So you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So Leia being Leia decides, okay, she changes the whole trajectory of the Halcyon Star Cruiser. Like, oh, no, we need to go to Madurs because we're going to get some fuel there, right? We're going to like, but so Madurs is a water moon, but it is encrusted in a thick crust of ice. So it's like the whole moon is made of water, but it's so cold that it's got this icy exterior that the cities are built on. Like you can, it's feet thick ice. And what I found interesting is, so our friend, Mike Celestino, he interviewed Beth Revis, and he on laughingplace.com, you can read some of that interview, but I'm going to read what she said, Beth Revis said about Madurs, because there's no better description than what the author says herself. For me, I wanted to deal with the climate of Hoth, in part because of the coldness of it, but also because Han had recently been frozen in carbonite. So that coldness of being frozen and also the coldness of Hoth were things I wanted to play with, but I wanted to turn it into a really beautiful world that was different and stood on its own. That's where the moon of Madurs came from, named for my two favorite science fiction authors, Madeline L'Engle and Ursula K. Le Guin. So Mad and Urse Madurs. I thought that was cool.
So now that you've read that, now we know why they say it that way. So it makes sense. It makes sense. The concepts that she used of the frozen and the different times when Han had to sort of deal with that, and he was kind of fighting past it.
Yes.
Because he wanted to protect Leia. And so you got to kind of get this little glimpse of sort of the trauma, because you don't think too much about it in Return of the Jedi, how much he's hasn't been there. And she even talks about that. He hasn't been there for a year, and Leia's experienced things for a year, and Luke has experienced them, and Leia can't even verbalize all the things that she went through to try to rescue him even. But the concept that every time he had to go into this coldness, and it was something he had to overcome, because he's very much, you know, you think of him as a cocky character, and this allowed him to be very vulnerable without changing how he participated in the story.
Right. Yeah. I loved that brought that out in him, and it was a form of PTSD as well. And also it was interesting, like those little moments where Leia's like hugging Chewie goodbye, you know, she's like, oh, Chewie is this so friendly with him, and Han realizes, oh, she's like been hanging out with him for a year that I haven't been there. Like it's kind of crazy.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then some way might have, you know, they weren't yet mourning him, but they were missing him together and driven by the same goal. Mm-hmm. That united them. So that was really important. I sort of felt like I kept saying to myself, I feel like Elsa has come to this planet and formed the ice palaces that we will stay in.
Yes. Yeah. How interesting was their architecture, because their city is formed completely out of ice. It's like igloos, but modern Star Wars igloos, because they are palace, like you said, like I did think in my head of Elsa's palace, how it's completely made of ice. But then Madurs has this source of that energy. It's like heat energy, I guess, cranium lace. And so like the cranium would be laced inside the walls of the ice palaces to make it warm. It's like, whoa, that's fancy.
Yeah. You know, we see this idea a lot in Star Wars of the Empire mining resources and, you know, government stripping resources. There's a shot in the Andor trailer of the looking quarry over that big kind of, huge strip mm-hmm. mine type of project. And so this idea of resources being, you know, taken for government and for technology and all that stuff. And as we talked about, this is the MacGuffin, the idea of needing resources for the government. It's not necessarily something that Leia wants, but she wants it because she wants the government that's going to be built, this idea that they're fighting for to succeed, and they need the resource. So by way of that, it becomes something she wants too, as well as an alliance. And for not to see people's lives destroyed, it reflects back to her loss of Alderaan. And this story is very much in that kind of eco-feminism type of story, which if you've seen Princess Mononoke or Mad Max Fury Road, where this idea of technology versus nature, and the idea of ecofeminism is that, even women wouldn't deal with things the same way that they would try to make community, to use resources in a way that isn't harmful. And so this kind of idea is embedded in the story. Hmm. It's not like totally overt, like beating you over the head, but it's there. And even George Lucas has always had that idea that extends straight back from Return of the Jedi with the Ewoks in there as being, you know, they live, their temple is part of a tree. They don't cut the tree down and make a temple. Like they live in the trees. They live in the trees. They live and they use the nature. And when they fight their battle in Return of the Jedi, they use the trees and the things. But they're not taking from nature in a way that it can't replenish itself in a way that isn't healthy.
Right.
And you even see that with, there's lots of little creatures in the story too. Mm-hmm. I liked the Prus.
Oh, they're like moose, right? I guess like Star Wars moose, sort of.
That's what I think of it. A Star Wars moose. Yeah, I would like artwork of them too.
That would be good. Yeah.
I like that they said that they pulled the sleds, but that they had their little kind of technology in there to kind of power them as well. And they complained if they didn't also use the, you know, if they had to work too hard.
Right, so. Right. Also, how I want to say like 1850s of this when Han and Leia arrive on this ice planet and the Prus come out with the sleds to bring all of the Halcyon guests to the city, you know, over an ice tundra. Like it was very like, let's take a carriage ride in the snow, you know, it was fun.
And of course they go off on their little trip. You know, the intrigue of this story is all that she writes these letters to these worlds and she gets this really cryptic response back from the leader, the prime minister, that, you know, come see our art. And there's already a resistance formed on this planet because of the imperial occupation that is revealed later on, but that they don't really want to tell them because they're afraid that of the repercussions if they tell them the Empire's there, but they want her to find out. And there's all these little things where, you know, she takes the Prus ride and they sort of swing by the destroyed city with the crushed palaces. And there's a big black spire up there that they're like, well, you know, Leia's like, what's that? And they're like, oh, nothing to see here, which sort of piques her interest. I think they were hoping she would just suspect it and come back, but you know, she was way more curious than they thought she would be, you know, on her honeymoon.
Yeah, no kidding. Yep.
It's like the girl already rerouted a whole cruise away from a beach planet. You just better know she's on a mission.
Yeah. And there were some other cool creatures. There was like the fish that lived, this is a water world, right? So there was fish and things that they were describing that they caught for, you know, to eat and stuff. But then they have another big creature. I kind of likened it to a whale, but an edont. And although you think it's more of like a giant squid?
It seemed to be kind of squiddy-like. Okay.
Well, regardless, something big.
One of the weird things is that the Halcyon is a Purgle class ship, and this was very much a Purgle-like event from Star Wars Rebels. So again, sort of leaning back on ideas and themes that we've seen previously in Star Wars. So I liked that whole sequence. I liked that sequence of Leia being like going through all this time of thinking about the Force, of thinking about needing to grab onto it as something she needed to possess and hold. And it was when she finally let go into it, which is what you want to do, and just trust and ask for help,
right?
That it's answered. And again, the idea of the Force is like nature. And we see that theme over and over in Star Wars, you know, nature versus technology. The Empire represents technology and might and its oppressive force, and this idea of just trusting in something, and you know, the people think, oh well, it just knew, like that Edont was down there and it was just like angry, so it came. But Leia is the only one that knows that she
kind of
trusted in something,
right? She asked and for help.
It did.
Exactly.
Back on that idea, there is a funny moment when Han and Leia are actually talking about the Force, and Han says, you know, as far as her approach to it, and Han says, Luke had to dump his X-wing in the swamp to find the Force. You just need to find your swamp. And this is what ends up being, she, instead of it being a swamp, she's in this like hopeless battle in the water. So, you know, it, not in her element. And that is her swamp in this moment, to kind of find the Force. So it echoes back to that.
Nice. I just want to bring up one other thing, how this novel can stand on its own. You know, you mentioned you haven't been reading a lot of the novels, and now you are have read this one and really liked it. I do want to mention one thing which I thought they might have brought up. And when we read the novel Leia, Princess of Alderaan, there's a moment in that one where she basically loses her virginity, but that's when her hair is unbraided as an Alderaanian.
Yep.
And I thought that might play in a little more with the wedding and like the wedding night and stuff. I thought that would be really neat. Only they don't. She just basically has the hairstyle that she has in Return of the Jedi on Endor, which is her hair is long with the two braids. So I was like, oh, darn. I thought that was really sexy.
Yeah. Well, I've read all the Leia books, all the Ahsoka books, all the Padme books. You can see a theme there.
That's all good.
Where I'm going with the books I have read.
Yeah.
It is nice though to have this sort of story that you can read that really is talking about some established characters, things that you might want to know more about. Obviously, we know that the Courts of Princess Leia isn't how it went down for them, although there's so many cool ideas from that story, like the Night Sisters,
Dathomir, the planets.
Dathomir, yeah, just all the things. And I remember I went back to that when I was writing the Dark Side book, that, you know, because I went into the Night Sisters and all these ideas. So there's so many cool things kind of embedded in that original story. But I feel like Beth Revis was true to kind of that idea of, you know, this planet that's sort of trying to be in harmony. It's different than Dathomir and that, but it's got its own way. It had its intrigue in it. So, you know, you have to find a vehicle to it, but it still felt very much, even though they're married, very much like a romance book, and that there's still something they have to overcome.
Right.
And that's how are we going to do this together?
Right. And even beyond the wedding, when they were together, there's many, many scenes, especially starting on the Halcyon, where they're in separate, they're separate, 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 separate. And they finally, by the end, kind of come together and learn to work together. But there's a lot of scenes where they're not together. And I found that interesting. And in comparing that to the Courtship of Princess Leia, like I like how Beth Revis, the emotion of it makes a lot more sense in terms of this storyline happening after Return of the Jedi for the reasons we just talked about. But I do feel like the Courtship of Princess Leia in general is just a more exciting book, because there's a lot more action and stuff happening. Like in the first 50 pages alone, you know, you have like lots of dialogue, tons of action scenes, and just the huge world building of like the Dathomir and the witches and all these interesting ideas which have followed. So I think each novel has merit on its own. And I think both really demand reading, because I think it's fun to read and just let your imagination wander. And, you know, just because one's a Legends novel doesn't mean it can't exist in your head.
Well, and especially people who are used to reading comics.
Yeah.
You know, you have this idea that you could relive multiple things different ways and have different stories. So like, I started out really heavily in fan fiction. Like, you get 20 different versions. I mean, I know whole universes where Anakin doesn't fall to the dark side, and you know, he and Padme have a family and they have kids and they have the same kind of problems, but they're just, you know, reinvented. So you can have like all those things. And
yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it's fun.
But back in the day, that was so much fun. Just all that discovering a Star Wars, like you just didn't have anything.
Yes. So
everything was like these you know, big moments. And
I think it also allowed your imagination to really, really just visualize this stuff in your head a lot more. Like, now we have all these TV shows, all these novels, all these movies, all these comics would show you, but like back then in the 90s, you had to like visualize it yourself. Oh, I just lived in that world.
And the one thing that we haven't seen from the courtship of Princess Leia, of all the things that have moved forward, is the Happy's Consortium.
Yes.
Which was where the prince was from. And there was the idea of they were like descended from pirates, right?
Yeah, I was just rereading this part. Yeah, how so like there's this like cluster of planets, it's like hard to get to, and like all these pirates would like steal these women basically and take them away to their home, and then eventually they would form families and whatever. So no, yeah, so like it's this whole society based on like pirates growing up.
That crazy like idea of this, you know, society, and then it was matriarchal. Yes. And the women, some of them seem to be force users or witch, you know, or witches. And, you know, it was just, and it ended up being that Han and Leia's daughter and son, and well, both the sons, Jaina, Jason, and Anakin, were friends with Tennel Ka, who was the daughter of Princess Solda.
Oh.
In the books. And so Tennel Ka had lost an arm in lightsaber training, I believe. And she refused to get a prosthetic. Mm. And she had this whole storyline in the New Jedi Order about struggling to, you know, they wanted her to come back and be the queen. She needed to do that. And she wanted to be a Jedi, and kind of how that, and then she had a kid that was Jason's kid, and everything went bad after that. Apparently having children is not good for
for force users or Star Wars.
Not good for Skywalkers or their descendants.
And that is one thing, speaking of this novel, like, I know when we talked about The Force Awakens, how, you know, Han and Leia's relationship was pretty much already dead at that point, and how amazing it would have been had they formed a life and, you know, like been together, and Han had died, it would just rip your heart out that much more. Like, I, you know, like that puts a little taint on reading this. Luckily, Beth Revis did a very good job in like living in the moment. And that was like her whole thing, is like discovering joy in the moment versus where is this marriage going? Because we already know where the marriage is going.
Well, losing Han in The Force Awakens obviously sets the stakes.
Yes.
But we've talked about this. It actually lowers the stakes for them to already be talking about their relationship that's
yes.
gone. I mean, it's going to hurt Leia, but she's essentially, you know, they're mourning when they're having the conversation, they're mourning their life together, where it had been really impactful. It would have been more impactful if she was still madly in love with mm-hmm. Han, and they were fighting still for what they believed in, but this happened. And it's even a bigger tragedy for her, the personal stakes, but it's just so J.J. Abrams. I mean, I've watched so many of his shows. He wants to come from the story of dysfunctional family. Hmm. And I suppose that's personal to him, but you could always tell that sort of just like pooped on the Han Leia shippers. Like
yeah.
that was just like a decision. And it always felt like the people who are in Lucasfilm, like they didn't have control over this. It was, you know, The Force Awakens was the story that was just happening in sort of this wild vat of decision making, and it was happening so fast that there wasn't this thing to say, hey, this is one little thing, could you change it, because we don't really, you know, we're gonna take Han away, but we don't need to take him that away. So it, in my mind, I'm like, okay, I'm just gonna take these sweet little moments and not worry too much about the other stuff mm-hmm. that happens. But yeah, it, you know, it's one of those things that you, in this story, you feel like there could always be things that test people maybe too far, but I felt like Han and Leia, like, we're going to be the ones, like we call them the one true pair, right? It's your person that you're going to be with. And sometimes stories are about meeting somebody and then meeting somebody else, but they're so embedded, I think, in fandom as this one true pair. And there are people who shipped Luke and Leia because
at the beginning, you didn't know.
There was no sibling relationship, But when it was ultimately cemented, it just felt like it was something that they needed to acknowledge into the next. And they did. They sort of acknowledged it in that there's a son, but nothing other than that.
Yeah.
But there is one nice little thing in this book, The Ring.
Yes.
Which Leia ends up with.
Oh yeah. My gosh, that was so surprising at the end. So we'll spoil it here because we can. Yeah. So I thought that was so cute. So Han and Leia get back to the Halcyon after they had this big adventure, and they have lost their rings that they got at their wedding ceremony because they were what they dissolved, right? I guess
they were yum rings.
They dissolved because they were made of amber, and they're not going to last. And so Han goes to the Halcyon gift shop.
Which is literally where you get it from.
Where you can get it from, and gets the ring that we see on her finger in The Force Awakens. It's the dual, like the two gemstone ring. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's so cool. And you can go to Galaxy's Edge and get it too. But yeah, so that's her wedding ring. Oh
yeah,
that makes it all the more special that she was still wearing it in The Force Awakens as well. I thought that was great.
Well, that was to me a nice little touch. I appreciated it. I know, Sarah, that you listened to this as an audiobook as well, or did you read it and listen?
So I started reading it. So I got about halfway through, and then the audiobook people reached out to me and said, "Hey, here's the audiobook." And I prefer to consume my media as an audiobook because then I can listen to it in the car, washing dishes, whatever I need to do. So then I listened to the rest of it on the audiobook. And so they did something really cool. So this is Penguin Random House audio. And instead of just having one person read, they had an alternating dual narration. So the chapters that were in Han's POV was Mark Thompson, and the chapters that were in Leia's POV was Saskia Marlevelt. And at the end, the final chapter, it's both of them reading together.
Oh, that's so sweet.
It was so cute. I was like, oh my gosh. And there's a really touching scene at the end of the novel too, that's very cute. And it was great to hear it read by both of them. So I do really suggest, if you like listening to audiobooks, definitely pick this up, because it was very dynamic with that. And then, of course, as the Star Wars audiobooks do, they add little sounds, little audio, little music in between the chapters. It's just, they do a really good job.
Yeah, I appreciate that the POV switches pretty quickly.
Yes.
So you're never like too invested, because there's so much happening that you sort of need to see both sides of the story. And Beth Revis is very good about staying in POV. Sometimes some of the Star Wars books, the authors aren't so good and they'll jump around kind of in headspace, but she's really tight. So what's happening is only what Han sees in the chapters that are there. And what's happening for Leia is only what Leia perceives, and strictly from her headspace. And so I really enjoyed not having to go, oop, they jumped heads, oops, you know, which happens sometimes, but she's very, very good
jumped
at it.
Heads.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, she is very good at it.
No jumping heads.
That's so funny. So overall, yeah, I think this definitely is worth a read. And if you want to, you know, read Courtship of Princess Leia along with it, I'm halfway through it again. I love picking that up too. And just, it's so much fun. So yeah, everyone go. Princess and the Scoundrel, Del Rey. It's out on the 16th, which should be when this podcast drops, or near there. So yeah.
Near there. So what else can people find us doing coming up? Because I think there's a lot of things coming from FANgirls Going Rogue.
There's a lot of things. We had a really busy week a couple weeks ago, doing a couple different press roundtables, right? And so we were able to do an Andor press roundtable. Trisha and I have seen the first four episodes. Oh my gosh, we can't say anything.
Can't say anything.
But we did get to speak to some of the people involved in Andor.
So you will be getting some really cool stuff from us coming up here in the next week.
Mm-hmm.
And we're excited to bring that to you guys. If you guys have not listened to our Light Magic episode about the documentary, about Lucasfilm that's done by Lawrence Kasdan, which, you know, that whole idea that Lawrence Kasdan went from rating Star Wars movies to doing a documentary about Industrial Light and Magic and all that stuff. We had a really great discussion and we got to put some pieces of interviews that we thought would be what our listeners would be excited to hear about, because there was a lot of interviewing and not all the questions are going to be, you know, maybe what people want to have the answers to, especially when we get a lot of international press, you get some really weird questions.
But, very weird. Yes.
Yeah. So we tried to really hone that into stuff that would be really cool and hear from Lawrence Kasdan, Phil Tippett, Dennis Murren, those people who'd worked on it. And we're going to do a follow-up. We did an interview with Janet Lewin, who is the head of Industrial Light Magic. And we're going to do her interview separately because we think they're kind of timeless and mm-hmm. we're excited for that too.
Yeah.
And as a disclaimer, as always, we were given The Princess and the Scoundrel by Delroy Star Wars for fair and honest thoughts on it. So there you go.
We've given our
good thoughts on this time.
I was like, we've given our fair and honest thoughts. I think so. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And we want to know what you guys think, you know, so please, if you've read it or anything like that, reach out to us because we love to talk about books and all that stuff.
I feel like us Leia fangirls have had a lot of goodness this year. So
yeah,
it has been a fun year. And for our Marvel fandom, I think we're in for a fun ride here because She-Hulk begins and we will be resuming our Facebook's Zoom discussions. So that will be talking about Marvel She-Hulk and then we'll get into Andor when it happens. We'll be talking about that, hosted by Sandra Shute. And you can find all the information on our Facebook page or send us a DM. And those are Saturdays, 8 p.m. Eastern time, 5 p.m. Pacific time, every Saturday, as long as there's a Marvel or Star Wars show on.
Woohoo. All right. You can visit us over at fangirlsgoingrogue.com and on social media. We are at FG Going Rogue. Trisha is at Fangirl Cantina. I am at Jedi Tink and Sandra is at Geek Chic 9.
You can leave us a voicemail, 331-21-EWOCS. That's 331-213-9657. Send us an email, contact@fangirlsgoingrogue.com.
And on Facebook, you can search for Fangirls Going Rogue. You can join our Facebook group. Just make sure you answer the questions that pop up or we cannot let you in.
And please go to Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to podcasts and leave a positive 5-star review. We need your review so more people can find us.
So until next time, go find your enchanted tree and da 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 da. Yub. Yub. Nice.
That was good.
All right. Yeah.
Nothing like reading a book and then discussing it.